I'm not the one who did all this. I'm the pretty face, as you may know. It was Saida, who was a postdoc of mine up until recently. Now she's a postdoc at UT Austin, working in their civil engineering department. And so I actually added one word to the title here just to clarify things. I added the word early. So normally when we're thinking about sulfate attack, we're thinking about damage that progresses over the course of several months. We're looking at what's going on in about the first 24 hours or so, okay? So this is not something that's normally looked at with respect to sulfate attack. So for clarity, I added that term early. Okay, so as many of us know, working in the area of concrete materials, sulfate attack is a big deal. Durability in general for concrete is a big deal. And so if we can do things to better understand why sulfate attack is going on and how the damage actually develops and progresses, that'll help us come up with better mitigation techniques and therefore reduce our expenses in maintaining our infrastructure. Okay, so sulfate attack, despite the fact that we've been aware of it for about 100 years or so, there are papers from the early 1900s that discuss deterioration of concrete in sulfate-rich solutions. It's still not fully understood, I would argue. It's pretty complicated in nature, typically associated with crystal growth pressures, such as with the salt, same kind of thing with the formation of etronite. There's discussion of whether that induces a disjoining pressure, depending on the type of crystal that's growing and so on. But it's usually associated with etronite formation anyways. Accelerated experiments don't always represent field response, which may indicate a lack of complete understanding of mechanisms. And so what we're hypothesizing here is that, you know, this expansive stress due to crystal growth pressure or the associated disjoining pressure of liquid surrounding these crystals is not the only thing going on, that you have, at a very early age, osmotic suction that could be developing the initial crack patterns in microcracks on the surface of this concrete that then grow later on due to these expansive growth pressures. And available models, as far as we know, don't account for this osmotic suction effect. All right, so what's going on with osmotic suction? Well, you heard thermodynamics mentioned by Homer in the last presentation. So this is a thermodynamic issue. You develop a spatial gradient and chemical pressure, chemical potential of a particular solvent. In this case, we're talking about water. So this gradient is the difference in chemical potential inside the concrete versus outside because you put some solution on the surface that has a very low chemical potential. And water flows from areas of high chemical potential to areas of low chemical potential. Chemical potential that can create a pressure gradient. Okay. So, just as a bit of an aside, this concept of water-driven flow due to chemical potential gradients—that's exactly how your cells migrate in your body, and that's why you'll die if you don't eat salt. So, all the doctors telling you to cut down on salt, telling them to forget it, you'll die without salt because your body can't migrate. All right, so how would this cause damage during sulfate attack? When you apply a sulfate solution to the surface of your concrete, you dramatically lower the chemical potential of that surface with water, such that it can become lower than the chemical potential of the water inside the concrete. That would draw water out of the concrete into that solution. So you would actually start to suck water out of the surface of your concrete. It's the same reason that concrete dries and you get shrinkage stresses due to drying. It's because when you start to dry out concrete, you get a reduction in the chemical potential of the pore fluid because the air chemical potential, the water in the air, is very low. It's a function of the relative humidity, and so you start to suck the water out. Okay, so it's completely analogous to early drying shrinkage. And it turns out if you add something like magnesium sulfate, if you get it to a fully saturated state, you get a water activity of about 0.1. That's essentially the equivalent of taking your concrete and sticking it in a relative humidity of 10% in terms of the driving force to suck water out of it. All right, so if you suck water out of the surface of this concrete, you should get contraction on that surface and get microcracking. By the way, these two images, one of them is microcrack pattern associated with sulfate attack, and one of them is microcrack pattern associated with drying shrinkage. So there's some similarities there in terms of the crack pattern. All right, so our objectives, in contrast to a lot of the other stuff you've seen here, we're not doing any experiments yet. This is a nice low budget Tran-SET study where we're just looking theoretically, is it possible that we can get stresses large enough to cause surface microcracking due to this particular mechanism? So it's a purely theoretical study. And so we developed a model to simply test this hypothesis by assessing the effect of osmotic suction on stresses and strains, and then also just doing some simulation where we change material constituent properties and the solution concentrations to see how that affects stresses and strains. So the modeling approach is using linear pore elasticity. So pore elasticity allows you to couple the effects of pore fluid pressurization and transport of pore fluid with stress and strain fields inside of a porous material. And so it lets us couple in how the water's moving through the pore network getting sucked out, how that affects the stress and strain of the porous material, in this case, porous concrete. So we simulated a cylindrical specimen, so a concrete cylinder, completely saturated. In this case, we simplified it and just said it's saturated with pure water. Of course, we know that's not the case for real concrete. It's got a pore solution. And then you dunk that concrete cylinder into a solution of some sort of a sulfate solution, okay? One big simplification that we made, just to make this thing easier to solve, given the time that we had to work on this particular project, is that the diffusion of the solute is much slower than the permeation of the solvent. So we're only looking at the effect of water getting sucked out, not the solutes getting sucked in. Okay, so that's just a major simplification. If you have diffusion going in much faster than the solvent going out, it significantly reduces these stresses. So the numbers you're going to see here are all way upper bounds in terms of the stresses in calculating. Of course, no reaction with the pore wall, so that you know the water and the solutes are not reacting in this case. So this is only very short-term exposure we're simulating, first 24 hours or so. So this is just a quick drawing schematic of what we're simulating. So we're only allowing for radial transport into this cylinder and out of this cylinder. And we can calculate the osmotic pressure in terms of the water activity. And this is a natural log function of the water activity, and this is just the molar volume of water, density of water, universal gas constant, and temperature, theta's temperature. And these are the governing equations for pore elasticity. So this top equation is just saying, it's just the conservation of linear momentum being conserved. This is the governing equation you get for combining the mass transfer with the constitutive equation, Darcy's law in this case for transfer. We put it all together, we get some nice equation. This is the constitutive equation relating stress to strains, along with the extra strain you get due to pore pressurization. So it's kind of like a thermal strain, right? You don't need any external stress, it's just because you pressurize the pores, you get some expansion or contraction volumetric strain. That's that last term there. So P here is the pore pressure, K is the bulk modulus, and B is another material property, material yield coefficient. All right, so I'm not going to get too deep into that, but we solve this equation for the given boundary conditions and initial conditions that we set forth with particular material properties, including permeability and so on. And what we get is immediately after you dip the cylinder, you get a really strong drop in pore pressure right at the surface. That means suction. The negative pressure here means a suction. Same kind of thing that happens when you dry out concrete. You get suction inside the pore fluid that causes contraction. So the surface of this concrete is going to want to rapidly contract. Interestingly enough, you see that the center actually goes up slightly. It's a Mandel-Pryor effect. What's happening there is because the external surface is contracting so much and the center doesn't want to, it actually pressurizes. It's a positive pressure in the very center of this thing. So it's like you're squeezing it. And of course, the boundary wants to contract much more than the center because you're sucking water out of the boundary much faster than you are out of the center of this thing. And so that's going to create tensile stresses right on the surface. And so you get a quick, sharp increase in tensile stress right on the surface that gradually goes down chemical potential of the pore water sort of evens out with time. Again, notice this timetable here. This is in seconds, right? This is all happening in the first day or so. Okay, so just wanted to reiterate that. And so in essence, what we're talking about here is a method by which we could be generating surface microcracking, okay, that then defines the crack pattern you get later on when you have expansion due to actinite formation. Okay? The effect of water activity is really important. So basically, the water activity is a function of how strong your concentration is. Okay? If you have a lot more sulfates in there, you're going to get a lot lower water activity on the surface, which is going to give you higher tangential stresses on the surface. Now, these numbers are absurdly high. Okay, and again, I remind you that these are very much upper bounds rather than realistic numbers, because these are going to be reduced some by the diffusion of the solute into the concrete. Okay, so a new sulfate attack early damage mechanism due to osmotic suction is proposed. You get a very high pressure gradient that'll develop near the surface of your concrete due to the fact that you are basically adding this chemical to the surface that creates this gradient in the water activity that creates a chemical potential gradient that's going to suck water out of it. I don't know if around here in Louisiana if they do this. I grew up in rural Michigan and we have a lot of dirt roads, and to keep them from getting dusty in the summer, what you add calcium chloride to them. The reason that works is because calcium chloride dramatically reduces the activity of water. So it starts sucking water out of the air to keep the road damp. Okay, exact same mechanism as what we're seeing is going on here on the surface of concrete. So they do that down here.
Sometimes.
Okay, and it works reasonably well.
It's already not. I'm from Oregon, from Midwest Iowa. So.
Oh, you are, and they do that there.
Oh, my parents paid for it.
Okay. So same mechanism, right? It, you dramatically reduce the water activity. You start sucking water out of air, or in this case, out of the concrete. And that gives you a sudden tensile stress right near the surface that can induce micro cracks that could then act as weak spots later. They can accelerate the process of expansion later on, and as well as define that crack pattern that you're going to see later on due to sulfate attack and the formation of etronite and the expansion. The higher the osmotic pressure gradient, the higher the tensile stresses, which means that if you've got a very low water activity on the surface, calcium chloride, in fact, lowers it a ton. That's why it works so well for that. It's got a very low water activity at full saturation. Also, if you have a low permeability, you can get a very high spike in that surface as well. So this is kind of interesting. But the results with respect to how permeability affects sulfate attack are very much mixed in the literature, and this might be partly why. So future work. It would be great to extend this model to include the long-term response, including incorporating the diffusion of sulfate ion. And this would be very cool because, you know, you get this initial osmotic suction at the surface that can cause microcracking, but as the solute moves in, you could ultimately later on get osmotic pressure rather than suction. You could actually use a positive pressure that could help contribute actually to that expansion that you get due to crystal growth pressure. So it could also play a role in the subsequent prolonged expansion that you get. That would require a much more complicated model and a whole bunch more money, but you know, hopefully we can get to that at some point. And then also carrying out experimental validation would be, of course, always a very good idea. You know, proving out something theoretically that is theoretically possible is great for giving a presentation like this, but is not always convincing to a lot of people, so the experiments would certainly be of value.